Hey, this is Tracy Byrd, and this is Real Life, Real Music.
Real Life, Real Music Radio. Your host, Kyle Hutton.
How you doing, Tracy?
Well, I walked off and left my hat earlier when we did sound check. So what y'all want? Hat tonight? No hat. No hat? Hat. Blake Shelton calls this my spray-painted cowboy hat. And I guess he's right. All right. Well, I may put it on later, you know.
Well, Tracy, thank you for thanks for being here tonight. I probably got that wrong. It wasn't North Dakota. It was Chicago or somewhere.
Well, no, when I talked to you on the phone, we were in North Dakota, and then we ended up in Wisconsin 4 days later. So we had Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday shows, so we were busy. We're busy all summer. So
Well, that's a good thing,
that's
right?
A good thing, yeah.
That's good. Great thing. Well, we appreciate you taking time out of your schedule. You don't have to come do this anytime. You do come do this with us, and I just want to tell you thank you for being a part of it.
I'm always glad to be asked. Thank you, folks, for being here.
Well, Tracy, I'm gonna lead you all over the place as we move through things tonight. But before I, you know, start getting bossy or telling you what to do, I wonder if you would just pick one out that you know you want these folks to hear tonight and just kick us off with something.
All right. Y'all help me. What do you want us to hear first?
All of them.
Well, then I'll just do one.
Yeah, there you go.
Let me tune this thing real quick here.
While Tracy's tuning, y'all please welcome local boy done good, Mr. Chad Ware, over here on lead guitar tonight.
From Dickinson, Texas.
Does Tracy let you turn your mic on over there, Chad?
I think he's got it on over there.
I got it on.
All right. You doing okay tonight?
Oh, yeah. Glad to be here.
Glad to have you back, man.
Thanks.
All right. Let's see. I think we're good. All right, Chad. Let's start with that one there. You ready? Tune it down. Tommy and Janie, barely 18, holding hands at the jewelry store. Eyes open wide, staring inside at the ring that they wanted for her. Mister, bring it closer. Mister, can we hold her? I think it's gonna fit just fine. As he slipped it on her hand, Janie kissed her man. Don't love, make a diamond shine. Don't love, make a diamond shine. It don't matter if it costs a dime. Dang thing looks like a million bucks sitting on the hand of a girl in love. Perfect 15 carat, stellar than dirt if the heart don't wear. Three little words, it'll knock you blind. Don't love, make a diamond shine. Play it, boy. Mercedes, she's living up in a high rise. Got a big old rock on her left hand. It looks cheaper than a Cracker Jack prize. Cause a man don't know that it ain't the dough. You know all you need to spend is time. And that big marquee, it'd be a laser beam. Don't love, make a diamond shine. Don't love, make a diamond shine. It don't matter if it like a million bucks sitting on the hand of a girl in love. Perfect 15 carat, stellar than dirt if the heart don't wear. Three little words, it'll knock you blind. Don't love, make a diamond shine. it cost a dime. Dang thing looks like a million bucks sitting on the hand of a girl in love. Thank you.
Very nice. Very nice. Okay, so I came across something. You know, Tracy, we've known each other for a while now. You did this show for the first time probably about 7 years ago, and I've had the pleasure of, you know, sharing the stage with you a couple times since then, and we've gotten to know each other. But I ran across something on the internet, so it has to be true.
Of course.
That I hadn't read before, and that was about, you know, how you kind of, I guess, people really started to figure out that you could sing, and it was one of your buddies talked you into going into the little recording booth at the mall or something and recording a song.
Yeah, there was back then there was a thing called the Recording Studios of America that had, it was a franchise. And it was in malls around the country. Well, I'm from Beaumont, Texas, and yeah, several of those in here. And they had put one into the Parkdale Mall in Beaumont. And me and my buddy were out there just doing what kids do, you know, just hanging out, walking around, you know, looking for girls at the mall, I guess. And he said, "Man, you ought to go in there and sing one of the songs." And I said, "No, man, I didn't do that," you know, because he was forced to hear me sing when we'd be riding around in the truck drinking beer. Well, he'd be, I'd be singing along with Merle Haggard or George Strait or whatever else we had. And this is when we were, 17, 18 years old. And I said, "All right, I'll go do it." So I go in there, and this is before really country had hit a big mainstream again. And so I went in there and looked at their list, because you had backing tracks, you know, and they had like four country songs on the entire catalog in the list that they had. It was like "You're Cheating Heart," "That's the Way Love Goes," and I forget the other two because I didn't do those. I ended up doing "You're Cheating Heart" and "That's the Way Love Goes." And so I'm just thinking, I'm going to do this. They're going to record it. We'll pay our money. We'll leave. Well, the lady comes out and she goes, "You know, you're really good." And I said, "No." I said, "I just, you know, sang around." And my buddy's like, "No, he's really good, isn't he?" I said, "Yeah." I said, I don't know about all that. But she said, "Well, have you ever played in front of anybody?" I said, "I have a guitar. I sing, you know, in front of my parents at home. You know, that's about it. Sit around the living room or whatever." And she said, "Would you like to sing in front of somebody?" And I said, and my buddy's nudging me, you know, "Yeah, come on, you do it, man, do it." And so I said, "Well, maybe." She goes, "Now you have to audition, but I think you'll get through the audition." So there was this thing called the Charlie Pruitt Country Music Show that they had at Jefferson Theater the third Saturday of every month back then in Beaumont. And Charlie Pruitt was a guy, he worked at the local DuPont plant, but he loved country music. And he always wanted to be a country singer and never did make it. So he's doing these shows, you know, to kind of, I guess, feed that fire. And they had a backup band, and I went and auditioned for him. I remember singing a Dwight Yoakam song during the audition, because Dwight was really big then, and I really liked Dwight. And he said, "You're in." And I said, "Oh, really?" And he goes, "Yeah." And so I always joke they had to drag me on stage because I was literally terrified. I almost quit. I mean, I almost ran. I mean, I've never done this.
Yeah,
you know. And now you're fixing to, you know, we did a rehearsal. I've never played with a band before. And so I go out there. I always joke they had to drag me on stage and they had to drag me off, because I got out there and got through the first song, which was I was big into Hank Sr. then, so I did a song called "Weary Blues from Waiting."
And then we did Folsom Prison Blues as the up-tempo number.
Yeah.
And I got a standing ovation. And they said, we've never had a standing ovation before. They said, and I said, well, what do we do? And he's got the mic, and he goes, well, that means you got to sing another song. I said, I don't know another song. Not with the band, anyway. And he said, well, just sing one of them again. So we turned around and did Folsom Prison Blues again, right
That's
behind Folsom
awesome.
Prison Blues.
That is awesome.
And that was kind of how it started. And I mean, I really, after that point, I didn't want to do anything else.
Mm. Well, do you, this is kind of putting you on the spot, but do you have anything that you play these days out on the road that's from one of those old influences that that you used to sing to?
We're always doing things from that. Any Gary Stewart fans out there? Tell this story about that one. It's funny, as I've gotten older, all these memories just still to this day, stuff that I don't remember in the last 30 something years start coming back into my head. And that song, I remember the first time I heard that song.
Really?
And I was 7 years old, and it was in my Uncle Bubba's 68 gold Camaro. He had just gotten the car, and he had come out to our house and asked my mom if he could take me for a ride. And she said yes, but she said, you don't go fast with him in that car, Bubba. He said, they called me T-Bird, him and the rest of my uncles. He said, I'd never go fast with T-Bird in a car. And so he went 50 miles an hour for about 3 or 4 miles, and then he floored it. And I remember it so vividly. because I thought it was just one of the coolest times of my life, you know, at that point. And all of a sudden he floored it and he looked over at me and said, T-Bird. I said, what, Uncle Bubba? He said, welcome to the 100-mile-an-hour world. And we were going 100 miles an hour, over 100 miles an hour. Wow. And he's driving with one hand, and he reaches over in between the console, the seats of the car, and he pulls out an 8-track tape and shoves it in the tape player, and that song kicks off.
Wow.
And it was new then, you know, I mean, in the 70s. And I remember it, like, is that, you know, vividly.
Wow.
Fast forward about 20 years, and I'm on stage with Gary Stewart singing Out of Hand.
Wow.
And so that's pretty cool.
That is cool. That is cool. Okay, so the 100 Mile an Hour Club is a perfect segue to where I wanted to go next, because turn off that cell phone, wherever that is. All right. Now all the people in San Luis Obispo.
Unless you're playing Gary Stewart.
That's right. People in San Luis Obispo, California get to hear that phone ring. Now, so 100 Mile Club, 100 Mile an Hour Club. One of the things that's amazing to me, Tracy, you know, okay, so there was a lot that happened between Parkdale Mall and that recording studio and you being in Nashville in 1992 and getting signed to MCA. But talk about going fast. You get signed to MCA in 1992, mm-hmm. and right out of the chute, I think it was your second single maybe, went number one, and it was a single called Holding Heaven, right?
Yeah.
And I want you to tell us about that song and about that time period and play it for us.
I thought that was too slow, you know, for the second single, because I just, at that time, I mean, everybody's first single, you know, on MCA anyway, you know, Trisha Yearwood had come out and her first one went to number one, then Chestnut right ahead of me, Too Cold at Home went to number one. And so then I released this song called That's the Thing About a Memory, a song that I wrote. You was asking me about my writing. Well, my writing took a hit right off the bat. So they wanted to release this song, That's the Thing About a Memory, and I was excited. I wrote it, and it went to 41 and died. And it barely was alive for but a few weeks on the charts. And I thought, oh, God. And my dad had told me he could get me on at DuPont, and so I was happy about that. Because it looked like that's where I was headed, right out of the chute. And then we came out with a song right after that called Someone to Give My Love To, an old remake of an old Johnny Paycheck song that I always loved. And it went to mid-20s, but our record came out during that. And that song, even though chart-wise it was only in the mid-20s, we sold. The album came out and far outdid. I mean, we sold like 200,000 units in the first 4 weeks, you know, which was really, really big. So they knew they were onto something, so I was feeling a little better. And then we came out with Holding Heaven, and it went to number one.
Yeah. So it's a great song.
But it was, you know, you live and die by those charts back then. I don't know what you do nowadays, but live and die by streams, I guess.
That's right.
But back then, it was charts came in on Tuesday morning, and man, it was I never slept on Monday nights, ever. I was just wide awake, going, "Oh God, I hope we get some ads. I hope this record does okay." But but Holding Heaven did good for us.
Face to face with an angel. How'd you get those eyes so blue? Your vision and why? And I've been waiting all night just to have one dance with you. Now all my dreams are coming true. I'm holding heaven in my arms tonight. Everything about you is so perfectly right. I've never been there, but I think I might be holding heaven in my arms tonight. I'm not sure where you came from, but I think my lucky stars above got the chance but one dance just ain't enough. I think I'm falling in love. I'm holding heaven in my arms tonight. Everything about you is so perfectly right. I've never been there, but I think
Thank you very much.
Nice.
Mr. Chad Ware.
Yeah. Okay, so Tracy, I mean, so you're looking, you're waking up, staying up on Monday nights, getting up on Monday morning, and you're looking at that chart. I mean, for a kid from the Golden Triangle, how did it feel to wake up that morning and see number one on that chart?
Oh, man. I mean, it was indescribable for me at that time in my life. And, like you say, the age I was young. I was fighting so hard to make it happen, you know. And when it finally does, it's a sweet feeling.
Yeah.
But the music business is pretty tough. The next single didn't get past 20.
Wait, so, what was the next one?
One that I thought was just going to be, I thought it was going to blow the roof off. It's called Why Don't That Telephone Ring?
Oh, that's my favorite. That's my favorite song.
It's everybody's favorite song, but evidently.
except for the program directors.
Yeah, they didn't like it, evidently. And, there's no rhyme or reason sometimes to why. A song's a hit or not a hit. And and that's still, it's a fantastic song, but just didn't get it.
I'm gonna ask him to in just a second. So we're talking about the very first studio record, self-entitled, Tracy Byrd, mm-hmm. Holding Heaven went number one. I didn't realize that Why Don't That Telephone Ring was the next single, but it's the next one on my notes right here. Yeah. And so who wrote that one? Because you've done a great job over the years picking songs, too.
Yeah, I don't even remember who wrote that song, but I'm sure they were disappointed. they probably thought like me, God, he just had a number one. Now we've got the next single. They probably went out and bought a new house or something. Yeah.
That's
too
fun.
Soon.
Yeah. So for those of us that are not in the, we'll say the music shopping business. I mean, from what I understand, when artists are looking for material, they got a stack of stuff that they're listening to.
Mm-hmm.
What was it about?
Thousands
what
of songs
was it about this song that jumped out and grabbed you?
The first line and it's so funny now in 2022. Or even in the last 20 years, to think about the first line of that song. The first line is, I had the operator call me back. She said my phone is working fine.
And kids are
how far have what? We? Yeah, kids are like, what's an operator? And if your phone's not working fine, you don't call an operator. You go down to Verizon and get them to look at it. But that's how long ago, that song has been. So, but it did that first line. I love great melodies. Obviously, they're important. But I'm a lyric guy. I always was on what I loved. I mean, it's the lyrics that spoke to me when I was a fan, and it's still the lyrics now that speak to me. It just real. Somber and had the operator call me back. She said my phone is working fine. Here in Louisville it's almost dawn, but it's 2 a.m. Pacific time.
That's strong. Will you play that one?
I can do a little of it. We hadn't done it in Chad's never done it.
Well, I promise we're a gracious audience.
Well, you're
right?
going to have to be. You might have to be very gracious. Let's see. I had the operator call me back. She said my phone is working fine. Here in Louisville, it's almost dawn, but it's 2 a.m. Pacific time. Thought sure she would have called by now to tell me all about that wild and crazy L.A. scene. Well, I know my number's in her book. Why don't that telephone ring? Don't she know I'm anxiously waiting, longing for her long-distance call? I wish I knew what her silence is saying. If my love means anything, why don't that telephone
yeah. That's a great song, man. Yeah. Golly. I love that song.
Yeah, it is a great song. There's a lot of great songs that get forgotten, you know.
Yeah.
And it's natural. I mean, if it's not played on the radio all the time, then, you know, it's not going to stick with people for a long time. But the real fans, they're the ones that come up to you and go, I love Why Don't That Telephone Ring.
Yeah,
those
right.
are the ones that, that's the kind of fan I used to be with you know, the guys that I loved. And because I always liked the tracks
cuts.
Track cuts that were a little deeper, you know.
Yeah.
That's ones I always liked the most.
Yeah. Well, let's go to the next record, because after the self-entitled record in 1993, Tracy Byrd, and there for a while, you were coming out with almost a record a year, weren't you?
Yeah, I mean, when you had a hit, it was literally, it's hard to even imagine now, but back then, in the early 90s, mid-90s, if you had a hit, it was literally to number one and gone in about 12 to 16 weeks.
Okay.
So we're talking 3, maybe 4 months. And so, man, they're just running them up and down, up and down. And they didn't want to release more than about 3 on a record. So, you know.
It was time.
As soon as you finished one, they were saying, okay, let's get to work on the next one. So we were just, you know, cranking them out as fast as they wanted them. And I do have to say also, we're in the early 90s. Michelle and I got married in 1991. And she was struggling through all this. Struggling through all this with me. And she hasn't hollered out yet tonight, which is a good thing. She told Kyle, she said, now he likes to exaggerate a lot. She said, if he starts exaggerating, I'm going to let everybody know that he's exaggerating a little bit.
So, I hadn't seen her hand go up yet.
Yeah,
I've been
so
watching.
I hadn't exaggerated enough to get a slap yet, I guess.
Well, hey, the night's early. But so the follow-up record to Tracy Byrd, the self-entitled record, was No Ordinary Man, and that came out probably early 94, I'm guessing, late 93?
Gosh, no, it was 94 at least.
Okay.
Yeah, it was probably summer of 94 maybe.
And that one had a bunch of hits on it, and that record went double platinum for you. So
yeah,
it's
actually went triple platinum now.
Wow, wow.
So that's pretty awesome. That one clicked, man. I mean, I don't know what made it click. You know, I had Keith Stigall and Tony Brown had produced all the stuff on the first record, and I don't remember why I moved, but I went to Jerry Crutchfield, who was kind of a Nashville legend, you know,
okay.
icon. We worked really hard. I mean, really, really hard. I was by that time, with the, you know, with the hits we had had and the first record doing so good, we were out on tour with Reba, and then I was doing all these other dates in between all those dates, and so literally I had Tuesday and Wednesday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday off during the week, and so I'd fly to Nashville and we would sit there and just barrel through tons of songs, you know. And we worked really, really hard finding the material, and obviously we found some songs that clicked. And the first single was Lifestyles of the Not So Rich and Famous.
Yeah.
Which the younger kids these days probably don't even realize there was a show called Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous at that time with Robin Leach. And so that was kind of a playoff of that. And then we come back with First Step, I think, or Watermelon Crawl, yep, or one of those. And then
you hit the ballad.
Yeah.
Right?
So then I'm out on tour with Reba and I'm doing this song that hasn't been a single, and people are just going crazy over it. And the day I walked in, this is how smart Jerry Crutchfield was, rest his soul. He passed away last year. But I walked into his, I was in one room, he was in his office, and we'd each just barrel through songs. And when we heard something, we'd come in there and go, okay, hey, come give me a second opinion on this. Either way, you know.
Yeah.
And I walked in his office fresh from the airport on that Monday afternoon, and he said, well, your tub of tapes, now this was cassette tapes back then, he said, your tub of tapes is in your room there. He said, but before you go in there, sit down. He said, I think I found your career record. That was his exact words.
Wow.
Is, I think I found your career record. And he played me Keeper of the Stars.
Well,
isn't that wild?
That's wild.
And you know, it was Song of the Year in 1995. So.
Yeah. Well, you can't not play that one now.
Nope.
You got your hopes up.
But old Crutchfield, just a little fun story. So that album gets rocking after Keeper of the Stars, and it's time for us to get started on the next record. And so it's sold 1.5 million, and it's selling, I don't know, 70,000-80,000 units a week. And Tony Brown, who's president of MCA, calls me in and says, I think it's time I take over your project again. But he didn't tell me until he had told Crutchfield. And I wasn't there when it happened, but a friend of mine from MCA Publishing was in his office. And Crutchfield had lost his voice box way back in the day. And so he talked like this. And his secretary rang in and said, Jerry, Tony Brown on line one. He goes, hold on, let me take this. And there was a girl he was producing on Decca Records, which was MCA's sister label, named Dawn Sears at the time, who I actually did a duet with. But he was producing her, and they had just fired him off of Dawn Sears. And so he answers the phone and goes, hello? Yeah. Okay. And he hung up the phone, and this guy that was sitting with him said, who was that? He goes, that was Tony Brown. They just fired me off the Dawn Sears project. Looks like they're firing me off Tracy Byrd. He goes, you know, it's getting harder and harder to be a legend in this town. And they did. That. They took it away from him, and I had no say-so on it. And he was a great man, and he did a great job. And But y'all have all, if you've listened to music through the 70s and 80s, you've heard so many Jerry Crutchfield records you don't even know. All the Tanya Tucker stuff, all that stuff. He was a great man.
Mm.
But he found me my career record before they fired him, thank goodness. It was no accident me finding you. Someone had a hand in it long before we ever knew.
Now I just can't believe you're in my life. Heaven smiling down on me as I look at you tonight. I tip my hand stars. He sure knew what he was doing when he joined these two hearts. Hey, I hold everything when I hold you in my arms, and I've got all. Soft moonlight on your face, oh, how you shine. Well, it takes my breath away just to look into your eyes. And I know I don't deserve a treasure like you, but there really are no words to show my gratitude. So I tip my hand to the keeper of the stars. He sure knew what he was doing when he joined these two. It was no accident, me finding you, someone had a hand in it, long before we ever knew.
And I don't know if y'all remember the video of that one, but Michelle and our daughter Evie were in the video, and Evie was, how old, Michelle? 6 weeks? 12 weeks? Not very old, huh? She's getting married in October, Evie is.
Come on.
She's 27 now.
Well, that might have been a career song, but I tell you what, that was a career record for you, too. And some of those other hits that you already named off, you can't get out of here without playing. So I'm going to go ahead and request one of my favorites, and that's the one you mentioned first, Lifestyles of the Not So Rich and Famous.
Well, let's do it.
It's fitting in Montgomery County, right?
Story about me and you. They'll be stringing up bright lights in the backyard, cameras on their shoulders, reading cue cards. Even Long John's on the line. The kids look dirty, that'll be just fine. They go gonna put us on lifestyles of the not so rich and famous, and see us go hog wild over beans and barbecue. They wanna see my fairly eat a bone blind. The holes in all our socks. We're talking about lifestyles of the not so rich and famous. Well, tell about your mama and the bowling league. Tell about Junior and his baseball team. I'll show my 9-point buck on the wall. We'll blow a few times on my new duck call. Let them see old Blue, how he sleeps all day. We'll bring out the Elvis TV tray. They're gonna put us on lifestyles of the not so rich and famous, and see us go hog wild over beans and barbecue. They wanna see my family.
Mr. Chad Ware, once again.
Yeah, man. Are y'all having a good time tonight so far? Is everybody doing okay? All right. So, listen, this is one of those moments. I need y'all. Y'all are like a crucial part of what we're about to do. Tracy, I need a liner to kick off the radio show and the video podcast, all right? So, we just need, this is Tracy Byrd, and this is Real Life, Real Music.
Okay, and then
you guys are going to go nuts, okay, for about 4 minutes, and then I'm going to cut you. I'm just
four
kidding.
4 minutes?
I'm kidding. Go nuts, and I'm going to tell you to stop, all right?
Hey, this is Tracy Byrd, and this is Real Life, Real Music.
That was good.
You got them started. That sounded like 1,000 people, didn't it?
That sounded good for
yes, sir.
Woodlands on a Tuesday night. Okay, so I want to ask you this. I just want to throw you another curveball right here. We're talking about your records from the 90s. But, man, you know, musicians and songwriters, you know, the where that comes from doesn't just dry up. You know what I mean? Like, you started doing this, like you said, because you were a fan and because the lyrics moved you and the music moved you. And you've had a bunch of hits and a lot of success. But I'm gonna guess that the creative outflow doesn't stop. So I want to ask you guys, you got anything that we haven't heard on a Tracy Byrd record yet that's new that maybe you'd play
for
us?
We've got a song that during COVID I was digging around in old recordings and found this song that I'd forgot that I ever even cut. And so we've started doing it again. It's called The Wild Side of You. So it's one of the newer things that we're thinking about if we do another record putting it on there. So has a fiddle intro, but we'll just try to wing it here, all right? I like your sweet style.
telling what you'll get into. I love the way you lose it, the crazy way you do what you do. Girl, I just can't get enough. I have such a good time keeping up. Well, you let go and cut loose to the wild side.
Some brand new Tracy Byrd right there. I like that.
Thank you, man.
I like that. Okay, so let's go back to No Ordinary Man. And, you know, we were talking up in the green room and kind of joking around. Some of the people that came upstairs, I think one of them said they had Keeper of the Stars sung at their wedding. And you've been taking a poll. Tracy's been trying to figure out the percentage of people that use that
song.
Yeah,
she said, there she is. She said that she had Keeper of the Stars in her wedding, but they were no longer married. And I told her that, you know, I get so many comments on Keeper of the Stars every night through the years since 95. And I've been keeping kind of a loose, not so official statistical survey. And she's in the 60th percentile. Just put it that way. So it's just a song. It's a great song, but it's no guarantee. Yeah.
But here's what I thought. I thought, you know, man, if Keeper of the Stars has been used in a lot of weddings, then I bet Watermelon Crawl has been used at a lot of divorce parties. Probably.
Probably, yeah. I would think... anywhere they're wanting to celebrate, Watermelon Crawl is usually played.
You don't play that one?
You want me to play that one now?
I think so. We can't get out of here without a little Watermelon Crawl.
Well, I was driving through Georgia in late July on a day hot enough to make the sign. Saw a homemade sign written in red, said Ryan County Watermelon Festival ahead. But I wasn't in a hurry. So I slowed down and took a two-lane road to a one-horse town. There was a party going on. When I got there, I heard a welcome speech from a small-town man. He said, we got 100 gallons of sweet red wine made from the biggest watermelons on the vine. Help yourself to some. Watermelon Queens said, let me show you something that you ain't never seen. Grabbed me by the arm, said, come on, let's go. She dipped down, spun around in do-si-do. She rocked back on her heels and dropped down to her knees. Crawled across the floor, then she jumped back on her feet. Well, and she jiggled, beat all you ever saw. This is how you do the watermelon crawl. And she said, we got 100 gallons of sweet red wine made from the biggest watermelons on the vine. Help yourself to some, but obey the law. If you drink, don't drive, do the watermelon crawl. Down in Georgia round about July, and you ain't in a hurry, then you ought to stop by. I can guarantee you're gonna have a ball learning how to do the watermelon crawl. Well, we've got 100 gallons of sweet red wine made from the biggest watermelons on the vine. Help yourself.
I told you guys I was going to have a little Porter Wagoner moment, old Grand Ole Opry style here during the show. And man, I want to say thank you again to our sponsors. You know, we're here tonight. This is probably show 281 or two. And we couldn't have made it this long without the help of our corporate sponsors and people that buy tickets like you guys. Thank you for doing that tonight. I want to point out the Griffin Realty Group. If you look on your table right there in front of you, you'll find a cool little deal here where you got a little picture of Tracy Byrd and some of his songs weaved into a little thing here from the Griffin Realty Group. But I want to tell you real quick, a lot of the times the sponsors that come here, I know them through music. They love music. They love to pour back into their communities. But in the case of the Griffin Realty Group, I can attest to them because I'm a client of theirs right now. We just sold our house. We're about to close in a couple of weeks. And these guys handled that transaction. And I don't know if you've tried to get your arms around the real estate market that we're in right now, but it's crazy, right? If you're going to sell, you got to figure out where you're going to go, and there's a lot to navigate. And I just want to tell you that these people back here at this table have done an amazing job for me and my family in helping us through that process. And if you're looking for somebody to, you know, help you figure out what your house is worth or maybe contemplate moving on to the next step that you want to take in your life, I personally encourage you to talk to the Griffin Realty Group. Y'all wave your hands back there so they can see again. Thanks for helping us make nights like tonight possible. Appreciate you guys so much. And also in front of you, you've got a couple of pieces of literature from my friends over at Caldwell Communities. They've got two communities right here in the area. Chambers Creek, which is up north, right off of 45 in Willis, Texas. It's a 55-plus community, and I've been able to get an advanced tour out there, and there's all kinds of cool stuff going on. I can promise you, Fred Caldwell's been developing properties all over the city of Houston, and this is kind of his coup de grace up here. He's going to put a Tom Lehman golf course in, and they got all kinds of stuff happening up there. So if you want to get out of the city and up to Willis, check out Chambers Creek. And then the Highlands is just south of here, just over in the Spring area, and it's another Caldwell Company's community that helps us sponsor tonight. So to the guests that are here tonight, thank you guys with Caldwell Communities. We appreciate everything you guys do. And then last but not least, they are the sponsor, and I didn't even tell you where you could see the video podcast, because there's a big difference in our radio broadcast and the video podcast. I know the obvious one, one's audio and one's video. But the other big deal is, if you want to watch the video podcast of what's going on tonight, it will be unedited. So seeing me drop my paper and Tracy Bird reach down and pick it up and so kindly put it back, that'll be in the finished video podcast. But on the radio show, we edit it down into a one-hour show, and so some of the stuff you won't get to hear again. So tune in on the radio. You can tune in on the video podcast. But Chicago Title is the sponsor of both our radio show and our video podcast. And man, we could not do this without you guys. So Lacey and team back there, thank you so much for everything you do to help us bring this music to the people. All right, that's my commercial. Now I'm gonna ask you about my all-time favorite Tracy Bird song. It's called Big Love.
Oh.
I wonder if you'd tell us about that song and play that one for us. Where'd you find that one?
Well, I was cutting several, now I'm going to forget his name. This is not good. But I'd cut several of this guy's songs. Why can't I remember his name right now? He's produces Luke Bryan now, so he found a better way than writing songs to make money, evidently. Because Luke Bryan has not done too bad.
No, he has not.
But anyway, I'd cut a song called I Want to Feel That Way Again, and it was a hit for us. And he sent over this song, and he said he said it when he sent it. He said, "Look, this is not an uncut song." He said, "This song, if you go back and look on a Chris LeDoux album called Haywire," he said he cut it. Yeah, he said he cut it on Haywire. He said, but he cut it way different than we. Than they had done the demo and the way they heard it, you know. And so I went back and listened to Chris's version, and it sounded like a totally different song, really, other than the lyrics. And I thought, well, you know, we always overcut at MCA. They really, really always pushed. And when I say overcut, they're going to put 10 songs on the record. They would have me cut 16. And so over there at MCA in the vault, there's probably 35, 40 songs that have never been heard by me. I guess they're just waiting on me to die now. and they'll put those out.
Jeff Stevens and Michael
Jeff,
Clark.
Jeff! Why couldn't I remember that? Jeff. Yeah, so Jeff Stevens, fantastic writer and great producer. And so that's kind of how that song came about. And once we cut it, I mean, like, sometimes you cut them in the studio and you go, man, that's pretty good. Hopefully it'll sound, we'll get it mastered and mixed and, you know, maybe it'll be a good one. But then sometimes you cut one and you go, oh, God, you don't have to master or mix or anything. You just go, that's a hit right there, you know, hope it was.
The video, what mountain were you standing on top of in that video?
All of that is in Winter Park, Colorado, but up even higher. We were at like 12,000 feet.
Wow.
And we shot the Big Love, we shot the album art and shot the video all of the same day, because that was the first single off the album. And it looked so beautiful that the videographer, the guy behind the camera, said, people are going to think this is fake. He said, it looks so perfect, they're going to think it's fake. So you'll see in that video a big canvas hanging in the middle of nowhere, just a canvas hanging of a painting of the skyline and the mountains. And they did that so that y'all would know that it wasn't fake. The canvas is right there, and the background is real. And because it was gorgeous. It was in the summertime, but there's still snow all up at 12,000 feet, you know. And it was just really, really beautiful. But that's how that all happened, and it was a hit for us. And I really love this song. I really, really like it. Chad, let me tune real quick, I think.
Y'all still doing okay out there? Everybody good? All right.
You want me to put it on?
All right.
Ma'am, I've had my hat on all night.
There's three. I'll be 56 in December, and there's three things that I'm glad I still have. My wife, my voice, and my hair. So every now and then, I let it breathe, you know? There you go. But you can't see my face anymore now, can you? All right, let me finish tuning this thing.
Did anybody eat the chicken fried steak tonight? Pretty good. What about the pork belly? Somebody ate pork belly? I heard that was
someone
really,
ate
really
that,
good.
Said it was real good. All right, Big Love. Here we go.
Big love.
Well, you had another big monster hit off the Big Love record with a Johnny Paycheck song. You mentioned old Johnny earlier.
Yeah,
too,
well, okay, and the story about that is we went back. So we went back in the studio to cut three more songs, and Tony Brown was producing them. And he said, "Do you have anything you want to cut, like an old song that you used to do?" And I said, "Yeah, Don't Take Her, She's All I've Got," the old Paycheck thing.
Yeah.
And he said, so this was on that first record. And he said, "Why don't we do," and I said, "Or Someone to Give My Love To." And he said, "Why don't we do Someone to Give My Love To?" He said, "And then down the road, we'll give it some time and we'll maybe do Don't Take Her, She's All I Got." Yeah. He said, "Don't let me forget about it." You know, he said, "Keep Don't Take Her in your mind." And so we did Someone to Give My Love To on that first record. And then on the Big Love record, he produced that also. And I said, "You know, we were going to do Don't Take Her." And we did it. And it was a hit. Bigger hit than Someone to Give My Love To was. "Well, I said, friend, and don't take her, she's all I've got. Please don't take her love away from me. Hey, I'm begging you, friend, don't take her, she's all I've got. She's everything in life I'll ever need. She is life when I want. Everything to me in life that life can give. She's my one when I need a trip. She's the first thought in my mind each time I try to think. And let me tell you now, friend, don't take her, she's all.
You know, Tracy came down. It was sometime earlier this year. We did that event over at the Woodlands Pavilion, raising money for a group here in town called Angel Reach that provides they provide help to kids in foster care in Montgomery yes. County. And Tracy, you came down and helped us raise a bunch of money for that cause. But one of the sponsors for that event was a group out of down in Spring, F1 Firearms, and they make some really cool. Ooh. They make some really cool guns.
They do.
And, they said they contacted one of the organizers who called me and said, "Hey, they want to give this. They want to give a gun to Tracy just to tell him thank you." And I said, "Well, first off, that's a really bad idea. Don't give Tracy a gun. He's from Beaumont, and you shouldn't do that." But they insisted, so they said, "What do you think Tracy would want on his gun?" And I said, "Well, I don't know exactly, but I'm gonna guess. Let's put a song title on Tracy's gun." And so the song title we chose was "I'm From the Country."
Yeah.
Because I figured if they didn't see that gun and didn't see that written on the side of it, they were in trouble.
Yeah, they had "I'm From the Country" on one side and "I Like It That Way" on the other. Yeah. Pretty cool. The Texas flag colors on the stock and everything.
That was
beautiful,
pretty neat.
Beautiful gun.
Pretty gun. Pretty, okay, that was my layup for you to play that song.
Well, let's do it then.
Yeah, we know how to work and we know how to play.
we like it that way.
Have y'all had a good time tonight? All right, Tracy, I got a couple more songs I want to ask you about. But first, man, I want to say this. I've loved your music for a long time, and having the opportunity to meet you and get to know you a little bit. It's evident spending a little bit of time with you and getting to talk with you about some of the things that are important to you today and some of the things that you've learned along the way, you know, through this amazing career that you've had. And man, you know, along with all of the hits and along with all of the, you know, the fame and the money and everything that comes with it, you know, there's a different side of that. It's a place where we can wind up in places that we didn't ever think we'd be, and life can wind up, you know, going down a road that we didn't think it would take. But man, one of the things that I'm most proud of, probably more proud than all the hits and everything else I know, is that that you're just where you are right now with your head on the way it is and your heart on the way it is. And man, tell us a little bit about, you know, you've been sober for 13 years now, if I'm getting that number right.
Yeah. Well, you know, I mean, this life, you know, not to be, you know, this is a serious question you asked, but comical things come to my mind. And I remember Kix Brooks saying that our job was like high school with money. And that's really what it's kind of like, you know, and so it can. I mean, you know, there's everything out there that you want to do wrong or you don't want to do wrong, and a lot of us go down that path, and I'm thankful for my wife and for forgiveness, for my God, and if you just, you know, if you just go back to that, there's always that place to go to.
Yeah.
And if you can. And when things, you know, when things just seem over and seem dark and seem like there's no way you can get out of something, or if you feel, you know, there's a lot of shame and a lot of things that you feel about yourself. There's always people that love you. There's always people that care. There's always a second chance. Or a third chance, or you just can't give up, you know?
Yeah.
You just can't give up and sink further into what you're already in, you know? And it's not the easiest thing to do. It's probably the hardest thing to do. I guess, you know, that's where a lot of people get bogged down, is it's easier just to keep doing what you're doing. Because that's what everybody expects of you already, you know? But it's hard to do, but you can do it, you know?
I want to ask you, definitely. I've heard you sing a song a couple of times, and it touches me every time you sing it. And I wonder if you'd play that one for us, and then I'll kind of wrap us up, and you can play us one more song. But there's a song you do called Only Jesus.
Yeah.
I wonder if you'd play that one
for us. Yeah, it's all about that, too, you know? Let's see. First time I met Jesus was down in Georgia on a vacant lot in an old revival tent. Preacher was calling for all the low-down sinners. I wasn't but 9 years old when I went running down to him. And my mama cried, and so did I. 'Cause my little soul say, next time time I met Jesus, while I was full of whiskey. 14 years later, on a washboard gravel road, I must have been doing 60 when I hit the water. That old car started sinking fast, and I thought that I was gone. And there ain't no doubt, if he hadn't pulled me out, well, I wouldn't be here today. Well, I know I've hurt him, and I don't deserve him, but he sticks by me anyway. Do you know? Time I met Jesus was at the birth of my daughter. With all that I'd done wrong, I was afraid it wouldn't go right. But she came in this world nothing less than perfect. Little face was shining in his ever-loving light. And I thanked him then, and I thank him now, when I laid down to die. I know I've hurt him, and I don't deserve him, but he sticks by me anyway. Do you know? Thank you.
Yeah.
And thanks also, I didn't write that song, but it found its way to me thanks to my friend Wynn Varbel for writing that and letting me cut it.
Great song. Have y'all had a good time tonight? Man, Tracy, I just want to say on behalf of everybody here, I know y'all, it was planes, trains, and automobiles to get here to be with us tonight, and you'll be back out, somewhere Midwest, East Coast, wherever you're going to be the rest of the week this week. But thanks for making your way down here and doing this with us tonight.
Thanks for having us back. It's a neat thing you do here. And you, can y'all believe he's done 240? Is that right?
I think we're 280, 282, 280, something like that.
280 of these things. This is great. He Kyle has become the curator of country music by doing all these things, and we really appreciate him having us on.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, so here's what I want to do. Since we just played that song about Jesus, I think the last one we do should be about tequila.
Oh! All right. I thought you...
Did you write this one to sing it at your AA meetings? Or,
No. I was still full throttle when I cut this record. Friend of mine, Casey Beathard, who has wrote so many hits, you can't even count them all. I'd cut a couple of his songs, and we hadn't had a single, but I'd cut a couple of great songs of his, and I was in town one time, and he was playing the Bluebird Cafe. The Bluebird's much like this in Nashville. Just a listening room, but it's mostly songwriters that play there. And he had asked me, why don't you come out tonight? And I said, man, all right, I'll come out. So I went out to the Bluebird, which I rarely did. And he played a song called No Shoes, No Shirt, No Problem. And he played 10 Rounds with Jose Cuervo. That was the two new songs that he played that night. And then he played some of the songs he'd already had hits on. And I went up straight to the stage as soon as they finished. And I said, in Nashville, if you want a song, you can put a hold on it. And I said, I want to put a hold on No Shoes, No Shirt, No Problem, and 10 Rounds with Jose Cuervo. And he went, Chesney's already got No Shoes, No Shirt. He said, I just didn't want to say anything about it. He said, but you can have 10 rounds. And I said, all right, awesome. And so we cut it, and it was a hit.
Awesome. Awesome.
Well, let's close out with that one tonight. And thank you
but
again.
A little note there. Casey didn't, they had written that song, and when they sent me the demo, it said around 9 or around 10, we were, or whatever it says that in the verse, it says, and they had put in, and we were down to the worm and about to give in. And so I had to call him. I said, you ain't drink much tequila, have you? He goes, why? I said, Cuervo don't have a worm in it. So that's when we wrote whatever it says. I can't think of lyrics till I start singing them. It's kind of like Mel Tillis. But anyway, so yeah, so they changed that for me. Here we go. All right, you ready?
Well, I walked in, the band just started. Singer couldn't carry a tune in a bucket, on a mission to drown her memory. But I thought, no way with all this ruckus. But after one round with Jose Cuervo, I caught my boots tapping along with the beat. And after two rounds with Jose Cuervo, that band was sounding pretty darn good. Some stranger asked me to dance, and I revealed to her my two left feet. Said, don't get me wrong, I'm glad you asked, but tonight's about me and an old memory. But after three rounds with Jose Cuervo, I let her lead me out on the floor. And after four rounds with Jose Cuervo, I was showing off moves never seen before. Should have stopped at two, I believe. Three rounds with Jose Cuervo. Five. Or was it four? Was it four or five? Six. Six. Six rounds with Jose Cuervo. Now we're back. Hey, how about eight rounds with Jose Cuervo? Ain't nobody nobody go 8 rounds with Jose, much less 10 rounds with Jose. Oh, send me home, boy, in a cab.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Tracy Byrd.
Mr. Chad Ware on the guitar.